Hello friends, I am very happy to connect with you all on the occasion of this webinar series being offered by exclusively the alumni of Karpagam College of Engineering. As most of you know, that this institution was started in the year 2000 with a student strength of around 120 and a faculty strength of just 8. Now in the last 20 years of journey, we have grown leaps and bounds, and today we stand tall with a student strength of around 4000 with 300 plus faculty serving in this institute. Now this phenomenal growth of the institute from 120 students to 4000 students was possible only with the footprints left by you all, the alumni of KCE. It's a really proud moment for me to connect with you all again. And I'm very happy that you have come forward to collaborate with KCE in a number of ways. One such initiative is this webinar being offered by you exclusively. So I am sure that thousands of our alumni have occupied various prestigious positions in industries and institutions. So their experience, when they share with our students and with the other attendees, it will be a real eye-opener for all of them. Once again, I thank you all for your contributions. Thank you very much on behalf of Karpagam College of Engineering. Thank you.
Hello everyone. On the occasion of KCE entering into 21st year, I am elated to meet all the alumni of KCE. I, as a faculty of mechanical engineering, feel privileged and honored to be part of their journey for 16 years that has grown leaps and bounds in all the verticals of education sector. At this junction, I wish to make a point that the department has grown from near 40 students and 6 faculties in the department to an alumni strength of 3000 plus students and 40 faculty members in a span of 20 years. The department has grown in all the areas, be it research, industry institute partnership cell, or ICT enabled education. As the head of the department, I personally invite all the KCEans to share their success stories. Thank you.
Active, and they have high desirable properties. They tend to react with the environmental elements and achieve ground or native state. This process of materials coming back to their native state to thrive in their native stable state is known as corrosion. Metals in corroded form lack all the desirable properties. Say it's going to be mechanical, chemical, or corrosion properties. Corrosion resistance properties preferably. Corrosion is inevitable part of metals. So what's the need to study about them? Let's see back our histories to know the need to study the corrosion mechanism and to understand them. Hope we all remember the Bhopal gas tragedy that happened in the year 1984. Investigations revealed that the corrosion of pipelines and instruments did not reveal the exact pressure inside the storage tank that had MICs, methyl isocyanates. Failure to notice the sudden pressure rise from 2 psi to 10 psi in an hour led to drastic failure of these storage tanks, causing huge loss to life, environment, and economy. Besides, there are many cases in history where stress corrosion of structures resulted in failure of Silver Bridge in USA, explosion of Nipro plant in England, sinking of tanker Erika, and there are many, many case histories dealing with catastrophic failures of structures. Coming towards the cost of corrosion, the world spends approximately $150 billion to monitor or to inhibit or to maintain the components or equipments and structures from corrosion. We could see here approximately 3.4% of global GDP is spent to rectify the ill effects of corrosion. Here in India, we spend 4.2% of our GDP, as we have humid climate that accelerates corrosion rate of most metals. We are just not limited with the histories that discuss on catastrophic failures. We have marvels in corrosion phenomenon in many artifacts. The first two idols of Shiva and Vishnu were made of bronze or panchalogas in the flourishing Chola period. They have resisted corrosion for more than 1,000 years. And we were the masters behind the wood steel, popularly called as Bukku in Tamil, that resisted corrosion and had both strength and hardness. Those were imported by the Syrians to make Damascus watts, the world's toughest and strongest watts in the ancient history. Yet to be solved mystery is the iron pillar at Delhi. It is a forged welded structure. It has been resisting corrosion since its inception before 700 years. The recent engineering structures include Bogibeel Bridge and Pamban Bridge. And we have been working tirelessly to combat corrosion in these bridges. And coming towards the Statue of Liberty, and this Statue of Liberty is one of the celebrated structures in the world that is constructed nearly 150 years ago. The world is unaware of the fact that it is just a corroded structure. Yes, it was made of copper bronze. The corrosion resulted in greenish tint to that structure. Irony is that we say the people in Western countries are far advanced in technologies even in this period of time. Okay, now let's move back to where we have started, the corrosion factors. Corrosion is predominantly influenced by the following factors to a greater extent. The first is the environment. Second, the stresses. Third, the temperature. Then the flow factors associated with movement of fluids over the surface, the microbes, and the selection of materials. Coming towards environment, so it is going to be a liquid environment or some temperature factors involved, corrosion rate of the materials will be higher. Added to that, high temperature also causes corrosion of metals. It is called hot temperature corrosion or high temperature corrosion. Even if there is no liquid interface, there will be cracking of entire metallic surface called scaling effect. And if there are particles or movement of particles or fluid or entrained particles in the fluid moving over a metal surface, there will be corrosion, and that corrosion will be at an accelerated phase. So how to test the metals? There are various methods to test the corrosion rate or the corrosion mechanism of materials. The first is simulated surface corrosion testing, in which we just install the metal piece in the exact environment, and then we monitor the corrosion rate or mechanism. Second is the laboratory corrosion testing, in which we use sophisticated instruments to measure the corrosion rate of materials. So of which the predominant ones are the electrochemical methods and immersion testing methods. Of late, we have been using this autoclave testing and cabinet testing methods too. So in this webinar, we'll be discussing on the electrochemical methods and immersion testing methods. Coming towards electrochemical corrosion analysis, the predominant or the first part we have to deal with electrochemical corrosion analysis is this electrochemical cell. So what is an electrochemical cell? It is just two conductive metal rods placed in a solution and they are just connected. What happens is one of the electrodes will just start to give electrons to the other electrode. So the electrode that loses electron is called anode, and the electrode that loses it gains electron is called cathode. So cathode is the electrode where reduction reaction takes place, and anode is the electrode where oxidation reaction takes place. So this property of metals depend on the activity of metals. So based on the activity of metals, they are arranged in series as given in this slide. You can see magnesium, aluminum, zinc, iron, copper, cobalt, nickel, platinum, and others. It is just a series. So if the leftmost ones are most active metals and the rightmost ones are more passive or more cathodic metals. So let's say if you are going to combine this magnesium with iron, let's say you have an interface of magnesium and iron in any structural application, what happens is This magnesium starts to give electron towards this iron. So what happens? This magnesium just corrodes away at a faster pace. So even if there is no liquid, there will be flow of electrons. So this is the principal mechanism that is used for analyzing this electrochemical corrosion analysis. So what we do here is the concept of polarization. So what is polarization is, we deliberately change the electrode potential from equilibrium value to the desired value. Let's say if the activity or this electrode potential of magnesium is minus 1.7 volt, we'll deliberately change that voltage right from minus 1.7 towards more negative and more positive side. Let's say if it's going to be minus 2.5 to plus 2.0. And then we just check what happens to the corrosion rate of the materials, and we can predict the corrosion mechanism from that too. We'll be seeing that in the forthcoming slides. And what we are doing is, we are forcibly making the electrode to behave as cathode by polarizing the specimen towards more negative potential. After that, what we do is, we forcibly make the electrode to behave as anode by polarizing the specimen towards more positive potential. So how we achieve this is using a potentiostat in an electrochemical workstation. So since we are changing the potential, it is called potentiodynamic polarization. So from this, we can just check if there is a limiting current, and we can investigate the corrosion mechanism, and we can just check if the corrosion is dominated by activation or concentration based kinetics. So activation is nothing but a reaction that is controlled by a metal electrolyte interface, but in concentration, mass transfer kinetics takes place, that is, the corrosion is controlled by diffusion in electrolytes. It happens in weak or aerated solutions, but preferably most of the metals undergo activation and concentration polarization in a combined way. So this is how we do electrochemical corrosion analysis. We'll have three electrodes. One is the working electrode. Second is the reference electrode. And third is the counter electrode. So the working electrode is the specimen that we are going to measure the corrosion rate. And here we'll be controlling the potential. And here we'll measure the current. And the reference electrode is used to measure the working electrode potential. And it maintains constant electrochemical potential as long as there is no current flow in it. And coming towards counter electrode, we use inert conductors like platinum or graphite, preferably use platinum as a counter electrode. So in potentiostat, the potentiostat is controls the voltage between the working electrode, that is our specimen, and the reference electrode, which is nothing but a platinum rod, ACE. It can be silver chloride electrode or standard Coulombian electrode. And this is achieved by injecting current into the cell, the counter electrode. Added to that, potentiostat measures the current flow between the working and counter electrodes. The controlled variable is the cell potential, and the measured one is the cell current. Coming towards electrochemical corrosion analysis, the specimen is used as working electrode. We have told already. So we'll see a case study on aluminum alloy AA5083. Here you can see the setup over here. The blue colored one is the working electrode. We have just masked it using cellophane tape. And standard Coulombian electrode is the one that is hanging, and it has been connected to that white colored clipper. And platinum wire as counter electrode, that could be seen as a red colored one. I hope it is not visible in this image. So what we have done is, we have used aluminum alloy as our working electrode with an exposure area of 1 mm². Other than that area, everything is masked using the cellophane tape. We have used simulated seawater solution, that is 3.5% of sodium chloride. We have tested this alloy at three temperatures, let's say it is going to be at 27 degrees Celsius, 45 degrees Celsius, and 60 degrees Celsius. So we have maintained open circuit potential for 60 minutes. Then that reference potential was used for anodic and cathodic polarization. So the specimens were polarized at a scan rate of 5 millivolt per second in the potential range of minus 1.5 volt to minus 0.5 volt. As we all know, the potential of this aluminum, most of the aluminum alloys lies between minus 0.7 and minus 0.8. That is the range, that is why we have gone with sweeping from minus 1.5 volt to minus 0.5 volt. So here we can see the graph between the potential and the current that is the current that is coming out of this electrode, and this is potential that we have changed from minus 1.5 to minus 0.5. The red color line tends at T2 temperature or at 65 degrees Celsius. The blue colored one at 27 degrees Celsius or at room temperature, and the green colored one is at 45 degrees Celsius. The specimen tested at T0 temperature follows typical charge transfer kinetics. However, the specimen tested at T1 temperature shows a limiting cathodic limiting current. We could observe more or less no variation in the current with change in potential in the green color line, that is called cathodic limiting current. This indicated that under these conditions, the cathodic reaction is mass transport controlled. And again, at higher temperature, at 65 degrees Celsius, the corrosion is controlled by charge transfer kinetics. So now we can just get an idea whether it is controlled by activation or charge transfer kinetics, activation or concentration controlled kinetics. Now let's move on how it is undergoing corrosion with respect to mechanisms. Then we have taken the specimen out and it is observed under high resolution scanning electron microscope. We could clearly see the corrosion pits over there that were observed on the surface. Generally, this entire thing is called pits, which is enlarged to a greater extent. You could see in this image. Generally, the anodic reaction is the formation of Al3 plus ion or aluminum ions in marine environment. And again, coming towards the principal cathodic reaction, in marine environments, cathodic reaction is the formation of hydroxide ions by the reduction of dissolved oxygen in the environment. The cathodic limiting current is achieved at 45 degrees Celsius because of the limited supply of the reacting species at that temperature. Why? Because oxygen has differential solubility at different temperatures. And how to calculate the corrosion rate? From that plot, to calculate the corrosion potential, I have just zoomed in to that blue color line over there. You could see from that plot to calculate the corrosion potential, corrosion current, and corrosion rate, what we do is we interpolate the corrosion plot as a smooth curve. Then the region of the curve in which a decade of current, that is 10 magnitude of current, goes linearly with respect to the potential is called as the Tufel region. In the Tufel region, we draw tangents to them. The point at which the tangents meet, let's say it is going to be beta C and beta A. Beta C corresponds to the slope line or tangent line for the cathodic curve, and beta A corresponds for anodic curve. So the point at which these tangents meet correspond to corrosion potential and corrosion current, which is indicated by I cor and E cor respectively. So from this I cor, I could calculate this corrosion rate from the equation that is given at the right hand side of this slide. Here, the E cor determines the thermodynamics tendency to undergo corrosion, and I cor indicates velocity of corrosion. So from this calculation, we found that the material goes high corrosion at 45 degrees Celsius with a corrosion rate of 10 mm per year approximately. And it is least subjected to corrosion at 0.08 mm per year at room temperature. And let's see one more case study on magnesium alloy AZ-91D. Generally, implants utilized for hot tissue fractures or engineer to interact with the biological systems. They substitute or support the functionalities of the damaged. Generally, people use stainless steel or titanium-based implants. But the thing is, the conventional implants have undesirably high strength and high Young's modulus. They have high stress shielding effect. Besides, they are non-biodegradable, and a secondary revision surgery is required after bone healing. However, in case of magnesium alloys, they just have marginal stress shielding effect than any other metallic materials. Why? Because their strength is similar to that of the human cortical bones. Let's say it's going to be around 40 megapascal. That's it. Magnesium has inherent ability to corrode in human physiological environment, which is rich in chloride ions, and this makes it biodegradable, and hence it is used as a principal material for biodegradable implant applications. Coming towards electrochemical corrosion analysis, here everything is similar. The working electrode is magnesium here, and standard calomel electrode was used as reference electrode, and platinum wire is used as counter electrode. Here the exposure area is around 1 mm². The electrolyte used in the former case was simulated seawater solution, which is 3.5% of sodium chloride. Here, since we are going to use this for biodegradable implant applications, we have to test with body fluids or simulated body fluids. So for that, what I have used is Dalbeco's phosphate buffered solution. So Dalbeco's phosphate buffered solution will just simulate the human body fluids, and it is composed of 6 salts, and the testing temperature is 37 plus or minus 0.1 degrees Celsius, which is similar to the human body temperature. And this will be done at a pH of 7.0, which is normally the body pH, human body pH. Here, in this case, we have done open circuit potential for 120 minutes. Why? Because magnesium is highly active, so it's preferred to go for open circuit potential for longer duration. And this reference potential, this was used as reference potential for anodic and cathodic polarization. So it is polarized at scan rate of 5 millivolt per second in the potential range of minus 2.5 volt to plus 2.0 volt. Here we can see a stable, after establishing a stable open circuit potential, we have done open potentiodynamic polarization. Here we can see that the specimen has undergone both charge transfer and mass transfer kinetics based corrosion mechanism. The ICOR is around the value shown over here, and the corrosion potential is around minus 1.448 volt. And the corrosion rate, which was extrapolated from this toughage region, is 4.49 mm per year. In the earlier case, it is easy to detect decorrosion, but many salts are present in the simulated body fluid or this Dalbeco's phosphate buffered solution. So it is hard to predict the corrosion mechanism. It is hard to predict this mechanism only with this electrochemical analysis. So it's imperative to perform one more test called immersion corrosion test. So it is shown over here how an immersion corrosion test is performed. Here what we do is we have to take the specimen, we have to place it inside a beaker that is filled with simulated body fluid. That has to be placed in a temperature controlled water bath. And this setup has to be left for 7 days. And to evaluate the corrosion mechanism on each and every day, so what we have done is we have done the test for 24 hours, 48 hours, 168 hours. Likewise, we have taken the specimen out, we have tested and examined using same EDS and XI that will be discussed in the next slides. So here we could see that the concentration of hydrogen ions or H+ ions decreases with increase in immersion period, as shown in the blue color trend line. This indicates evolution of hydrogen gas as a result of corrosion phenomenon. However, coming towards the corrosion rate of the specimens, the corrosion rate after 24 hours of immersion was 4.37 mm per year. This corrosion rate decreased and stabilized at an average corrosion rate of 1.05 mm per year after 144 hours of immersion. So we can see a trend of decreasing trend in corrosion rate by 50%, 29%, and ending at 0.02% with respect to increase in immersion period. So this indicates that something has happened, that prohibited further corrosion of metals. We need to investigate that. So what we have done is, we have taken the specimens after 24 hours of immersion and we have observed it under the scanning electron microscope. We can see a cracked surface, and after 72 hours of immersion, there were more corrosion products on the surface. Everything was at some similar magnifications. And after 120 hours of immersion, what happened is the flower-like clusters were fell off. And after 168 hours of immersion, we could see a formation of stable corrosion products over the entire surface. So during the initial hours of immersion, the formation of magnesium hydroxide prevented the adsorption of calcium and phosphorus on the surface. The calcium and phosphorus are present in this SBF or human body fluids. The chloride ions caused continuous corrosion and hence removal of magnesium hydroxide as magnesium chloride. These created cracks over the surface. So this eventually led to blooming of flower-like clusters over the surface after 24 hours of immersion. However, what happened is, the magnesium hydroxide, once started to grow, was dissolved by formation of magnesium chloride during 72 hours and after 120 hours of immersion. And after that, there is again a bloom of corrosion products. That is what we need to explain. So that could be explained using this EDS analysis. To understand this corrosion mechanism, so we have done some EDS analysis. So we have taken EDS analysis over those corrosion products. So the EDS analysis is shown over here. We could see that on the corrosion products, the peaks indicated the presence of magnesium, sodium, calcium, phosphorus, chlorine, and oxygen. Initially, the calcium to phosphorus ratio was a bit higher. This decreased with increase in immersion time. Let's say it's over here, IC1 and IC7, which indicates specimen after 24 hours, and IC7 indicates after 168 hours. The calcium to phosphorus ratio was initially higher, and it decreased to a value of 1.67 in the later stages. The calcium to phosphorus ratio was found to be approximately 1.67. This indicates formation of hydroxyapatite layer favorably or calcium magnesium phosphate layer favorably. To ascertain this fact, we have done elemental mapping and XRD analysis that is shown over here. Here you could see how the elements are dispersed over the corrosion products, which is shown in green, yellow, violet, and orange colored figures that is shown over here. We can see that a high concentration of calcium and phosphorus in the corrosion layer. This is attributed to calcium phosphorus salt. So in addition, what we have done is, we have done XRD analysis and we have detected prominent peaks for alpha phase and beta phase of the alloy. That has happened to be alpha magnesium and beta magnesium 17 aryl. They are the primary and secondary phases in the matrix. Then we have detected many peaks between 20 and 35 degrees Celsius. And these peaks indicate that the peaks are like hydroxyapatite or calcium magnesium phosphate. So these are just confirmatory tests to ascertain that the formed corrosion products are of calcium magnesium phosphate or hydroxyapatite. These hydroxyapatite and calcium magnesium phosphate layers are adherent layers. Like they will not allow any further interaction of this liquid medium with the metal that is lying below the corrosion layer. That is why the corrosion rate have decreased to a greater extent. It started at 4.37 mm per year and it ended at 1.05 mm per year. So the typical corrosion mechanism is presented here. Here is the just blank metal. So what happens is, initially magnesium ions dissolved and magnesium hydroxide layer is formed. It acted as potential barrier to absorb calcium and phosphorus. And then what happened is, magnesium hydroxide is vulnerable to this magnesium chloride. It's vulnerable to chloride ions and it forms magnesium chloride. It just goes on into solution. That is why initially the corrosion rate is higher. Then what happened is, magnesium combined with this calcium and phosphorus to form adherent layers of calcium hydroxyapatite or calcium magnesium phosphate layer. So after this, the corrosion rate is retarded. So in a summary, we could see what is a corrosion, what is the cost of corrosion. We have seen the electrochemical corrosion characteristics, the potentiodynamic polarization method to evaluate the corrosion, the immersion corrosion methodology, aluminum magnesium alloy and magnesium aluminum alloy. If you have any queries, you could ask me right now.
Students, if you have any queries, you can ask. There is a query in the chat box.
Yeah, just a minute. So, coming towards corrosion rate calculation, it is just nothing but weight loss methods. We just take the specimen, we polish it as per the ASTM standards. Then what we do is, we just take the weight in a precision balance. And after that, we just keep into solution. After certain period, days or whatever we want, we take the specimens out, we clean the corrosion products. And then we take the measurement of weight again. So the loss in weight can be converted into corrosion rate using the equation. And coming towards job opportunities, yeah, we have a wide range of opportunities. Like if we are a NACE certified persons, then there is huge opportunity for us to evaluate the corrosion structures. And NACE offers many programs with respect to nuclear inspection or with respect to some structural inspection related programs. We could opt in, we have to complete the course, then we are with n number of opportunities. Yeah, of course, it is mass loss in terms of mm per year. You have a conversion factor K, okay? So corrosion rate equals conversion factor K into del M, that is the mass loss divided by the surface area and the density. Okay, that's it. I hope it is always available in the internet. You can just go into a website called Corrosion Doctors. You could find a wide range of formulas for calculating this immersion corrosion test. Thank you.
Guys, if you have any queries, you can type in the chat box. As there are no more queries, we can end this session. Thank you, Dr. R. Vairavignesh, for your valuable time. The session was informative, and I hope all the students would have benefited from it.
Yeah, thank you, Anna.